Since today is Rosh Chodesh Adar, today we said many times Yad HaVeYavoy. We're going to say it tomorrow as well. I want to ask the Tzibur HaChashul that's sitting here tonight a question that Maran Sarah Torah, Rabbi Reb Chaim Kanievsky, asked his grandson. A few years ago, his grandson came to visit him, and Reb Chaim asked him, he said, "You daven with kavanah?" "I try." "But do you really look into the words? You understand what you're saying?" "I try." So Reb Chaim asked him, "Tell me, how many different bakashos, how many different requests are there in Yad HaVeYavoy?" We all said Yad HaVeYavoy today many times. Rabboisai, Rabbonim Chashuvim, how many different bakashos are in Yad HaVeYavoy? What do you say, Rabboisai? How many? How many? How many? Not everybody together.
Seven.
No. Somebody said 10. Not even close. Give me a number.
Eight.
10 is not even close. 8, you're going down. We're going way up. 40. Not even close. How many times did you say Yad HaVeYavoy today? You still have a chance tomorrow.
Oh.
Rabboisai, Reb Chaim Kanievsky told his grandson the following. It's very choshev, pay attention because we're going to say it. Yemez Hashem, those who ate bread today, tomorrow during davening. Yale is one, ve'yavoy, ve'yagia ve'yeroe, ve'yerotze, ve'yishoma, ve'yipoket, ve'yizocha zichoneinu, and ve'yitoneinu, ve'zichon avoseinu. We're already up to 10. We didn't even start. Ve'zichon Mashiach ben David avdecho, ve'zichon Yerushalayim kodshecha, and ve'zichon kol amcha beis Yisrael. How many requests we have up to here? 13 different bakashos, but it doesn't stop here. Because each one of these we ask that it should be lefleita and letoiva, aber lechen ulechesed ulerachamim lechaim ulesholoi. So we need to multiply 13 by 7, and that is
91.
We're not over, we're not done yet. At the end, we request again a Kodesh Baruch Hu, Zochreinu Hashem Elokeinu Boy, Letoiva. And also, Ufogdeinu. It should be Levracho. And then, Vehoshienu Volechaim, Uvidvar Yeshua Veachamim, Chus, Vechoneinu, that's 7. Verachem, that's 8. Vehoshienu, that's 9. 91 plus 9, 100 Bakashos. When do we say this? On Rosh Chodesh, on Pesach, on Sukkot, and on Shavuos. So that's 100 times 4. We ask 400 different bakashos on Yad HaVeYavoy. That's because it's Rosh Chodesh Adar. Rabbi used to open up with Milsa de Bichusa. We start with that. But just in a few days, we're going to read in Parshas Truma. So we ask for the building of Beis Hamikdash every single day. So many times every single day. But who is supposed to build a Beis Hamikdash? The Eibishter. Let's see. Rabbeinu Bechaye in Parsha Shmini, Perek Yud Alef. Pilei Ploim of Rabbeinu Bechaye. He brings a medesh that we don't have that medesh. Medesh Tanhuma. You know what? Maybe let's backtrack. Another shayla. A riddle. Who asked this riddle? Rabbeinu Ahi Ben Ezra. Rabbeinu Ahi Ben Ezra was an Ish Ashkolois. Ish Shehakol Boy. He was a doctor. He was a philosopher. He was a darshan. He was a poisek. He was everything. Rabbeinu Ahi Ben Ezra writes. Listen to this startling sentence. Toamti ta'am ha-chazir v'ta'amo ke'ta'am ha-gamal. I have tasted the taste, the flavor of chazir, and it has the same taste as the camel. Bilei ploy. The Ibn Ezra says, I have tasted chazir, and it has the same taste as a camel. Did you ever hear anything like this?
How is this possible? Shomu Shamayim.
We don't know the Ibn Ezra to be a Ger Tzedek. We don't know him to be a Baal Tshuva. As far as we know, he sat in the Mir, or maybe here. He sat in the Lakewood. I don't know. I don't know where he sat, but he was a Yeshiva Boch. How in the world is the Ibn Ezra says, I have tasted Chazir? Oh, you're probably saying, in Chulin Daf Kuf Tes Amud Beis, coming up in about 40 days for the Daf Yoimi, Yalta, the wife of Nachman, teaches him, you know, everything which HaKadosh Baruch Hu answered to us, there is a comparable sample which is allowed, and she gives him a list. One of the things is Chazir. You're not allowed to eat Chazir, but you are allowed to eat a fish by the name of Shibuta. Rashi explains it's a big fish, and the taste of its brain has the same flavor of Chazir. According to the Girsan Yalkut Shimoni, it's the tongue of the Shibuta. And even if you want to say that's what he means when he says, I tasted the chazir, but we don't know the comparable sample of the camel, so what in the world did the Ibn Ezra mean? Rabbi say, what do you do with such a thing? It's the Ibn Ezra! Anyone has an answer? The answer is amazing, because both in Parsha Shemini and in Parsha Sreye, and you should use this in your communities, when the Torah lists those animals you're allowed to eat, and those that you are not. The tam, the drop, on the word esachazir is klisha gdoila, esachazir, says Ibn Ezra, oh, I'm familiar with this. Three psukim ago, I tasted the same tam, the same drop, on esagama, the same tam. I have tasted the chazir, it's the same taste, not taste, tam, drop, as the gama. But why am I bringing this here? What is this connection to Beis HaMikdash? Because some answer the question of the Ibn Ezra in a different way. In many places in Chazal, we see that the nations of the world are compared to different animals. And the Edomites, Edom is Chazir. And the camel is Madai. And so on and so forth, says the Ibn Ezra. Ezra, the more things change, the more they stay the same. They don't like us, just like the previous speaker said before me. I have tasted the hands of Edom, of the Chazir. It's the same thing, just like the camel. They all don't like us. With that, we go back to what we started, Rabbeinu Bechaye. An amazing Rabbeinu Bechaye in Parsha Shemini. Lama nikra shemoi Chazir. Why is he called Chazir? A play on words. So everybody knows the Ora Chaim that brings the Tanhuma that, again, we don't have. She'asid li'yo lachzor li'yo smuta, a play on words. Chazir in the future will be muta. A whole big discussion how is that possible. But Rabbeinu Bechaye brings the medrash that says, Lama nikra shmoi chazir, Malchus Edom le'hachazir atara le'yoishna. To make it a little easier to understand, you know, I live in Eretz Yisrael. I just came in this morning. If you go to a store that sells breakable items, there's usually a sign. Two words. Shavarta, shilamta. You break, you pay. They destroyed the Beis HaMikdash. They have to rebuild. Lama nikra shmoi chazir. Play on words. She'asida umazu le'achazir atara le'yoishna. This nation destroyed it. This nation will rebuild. So who is supposed to build Beis HaMikdash? According to Rabbeinu Bechaye, Edom. There's a sefer called Meshivas Nefesh. It has a lot of weight because that's Dod Zkeno of the Maharshal, the uncle of the grandfather of the Maharshal. And he writes, Klal Yisrael has to build the Beis HaMikdash. And this seems consistent with the Rambam. Because in Hilchos Beis HaBchira, Perek Aleph Halacha Aleph, the Lashon of the Rambam is very clear. Mitzvas Ese. Livnos by Smuchan Hashem Lios Makrivim Boya Korbanos. It's a positive mitzvah incumbent on us to build a house for Kodesh Baruch Hu to bring in the sacrifice, a house for Kodesh Baruch Hu service. This seems to contradict the Rambam himself, because at the end of Hilchos Melachim, the Rambam says this is one of the duties of Mashiach. And in fact, that's one of the signs. How do you know Mashiach is here? He has to bring the ingathering and he has to build a Beis HaMikdash. So up to now, how many different opinions do we have? We're not done. According to Vayikra Rabbah, according to Medrash Tanhum, according to the Zohar HaKodesh, according to Baba Kama Daf Samech Amud Beis, HaKodesh Baruch Hu has to build the Beis HaMikdash. Says HaKodesh Baruch Hu, Ani Hitzati HaBe'esh, I lit the fire, and therefore Be'esh Ani Asid Livnoisa, and I will rebuild it with fire, Shenemar, a pasuk from Yirmiyah, V'ani Ha'yelan Choymas Esh, Ne'um Hashem, HaKodesh Baruch Hu is going to bring the house with a wall of fire. I'm already confused. Who is going to build the Beis HaMikdash? Four different opinions. Mashiach, Klal Yisrael, Edom, HaKodesh Baruch Hu. So how does this work? How does this all work? Before we answer how does this all work, tell me, how was Beis HaMikdash destroyed? An atom bomb? Missiles? How was it destroyed? Anyone knows?
Fire.
What's that?
Fire!
Migilal Kvoido Sodze. How do you know? Who told you? Were you there? How do you know it was fire?
I read about it.
Where did you read about it? Your problem is sending us to Gittin Nun Zayin, where after the whole Maisa with Kamsa and Bakamsa, Chazal say, Bohu et Hamakdoila Koycha Shalbusha, look how great is the Koyach of embarrassment. That HaKodesh Baruch Hu assisted Bar Kamtza, and what happened as a result of the language of Chazal, the Sarfaya Seichaleinu, and our Beis HaMikdash was put on fire. So everybody is in agreement, Beis HaMikdash was burnt in flames, right? It's a quote from Baba Kama Daf Samech Amud Beis, what you're saying. However, there is a Beinu Achido in Midbar Kademos Ma'areches Mem Ois Mem Gimel. He brings from a sefer called Chatz Vashiva. But you don't need a Beinu Achida because this is Mefoyresh in the Zohar HaKodosh. To hear what I'm about to tell you now, you have to put your seatbelts on. Zohar HaKodosh in Pikudei Reish Mem Amud Beis says the Zohar Beis HaMikdash was not destroyed. You're still seeing, as if everything's okay. Did you hear what I said? The Zohar HaKodesh says Beis HaMikdash was not destroyed, and we mourn for 2,000 years. Says the Zohar HaKodesh, HaKodesh Baruch Hu wanted to satiate the eye of Oysor Rasha, Titus. What did he do? Here in America, there's a big slogan: fake news. What did HaKodesh Baruch Hu do? He brought a fake Beis HaMikdash. He had angels carrying masreifos and seed and levanium and fire, bricks and fire, and there was a mini Beis HaMikdash, just like a real Beis HaMikdash, and that was put in fire, but the real Beis HaMikdash was nignas, it was stored. This fits very well with Gittin Nun Zayin, where Chazal say that Pirchei Kehuna, the young Kohanim, went out and they threw the keys to the Beis HaMikdash and they said, we are not worthy of it, and even the keys were taken away. Nothing of Beis HaMikdash would fail into the hands of the Rishayim. Have children. Everybody cries. And the unbelievable thing happened 9 months later, a baby boy, and Meir is still alive. Meir picks up the baby. He looks at his young, new wife. And he tells her, it is clear to me that the only reason we were zoiche to have this child is because of the holy mouth of Reb Moshe. Tzadik Oizer, HaKodesh Baruch Hu Mekayim, Birkas HaTzadik, Koyach HaTzadik. It's clear to me that is the only reason we have this kid. But wait a second. Let's be medayek what Reb Moshe said. He said, I'm going to give you a bracha, you shall have children. Miut Rabbi? Shnai. He didn't say a child, he said children. Therefore, I am convinced that I will not leave this world before I have another kid. Dear Kala, I have one favor to ask of you. Only if you agree. My Kala, if you don't mind too much, We will be husband and wife, but let's not be together for 50 years. Then we'll have another kid. If you agree, you give me a matnas chayim, you give me 15 years of life, because I know that I will not depart from this world until I have another kid. Moshe said so. On the spot, the kala with mesilus nefesh says, Naaseh v'nishma. And they immediately run to the Moshe to report, to tell him their decision. Moshe hears this and he says to them, nine, Ayid has to govern and conduct his ways according to the path of Torah. And the Torah commands you, you have a mitzvah now called Tru Urevu, be fruitful and multiply. The Kodesh Baruch Hu wants you to have children. Don't do cheshboino shel ma'ila. This is not your cheshbon to do. Chosen and Kala, Naaseh v'nishma. The unbelievable thing happens, another 9 months and another baby boy. And Meir is still alive. 10 days later, Meir left this world. America is in mourning. The Kotler family is in mourning. Everybody comes to visit. Everybody comes to the Menachem Avel. The Belozhev Rebbe came. And the Belozhev Rebbe looks at Reb Schneer and tells him, you know, our matzav is kind of similar. Actually, no, you are better off than me. Because at least you have a matzeva to cry over. I don't. The Belozhev Rebbe is a Holocaust survivor. I left my son, he says. The gas chambers in Auschwitz. You have a continuation from me. You have two grandchildren. I don't. And Reb Schneer told him, Nichamtani, Rebbe, Nichamtani. Ad kan hakof ve'alef. Now you really have to put your seatbelts on. The Avelus period is over. And the Kala, who just lost her husband, wants to build a Bais Ne'eman b'Yisrael, and she's looking for a Shidduch. She looks and she finds a widower like her. She had two boys and he had a few kids. They got married and they want to have kids together. A year, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years. No. They went to the doctors. The doctor said to him, you're fine. The doctor said to her, you're fine. They continued going to doctors until they got to the top specialist in the United States of America who deals with these matters. A battery of tests. Then he calls them to the office and he says to the wife, Behai Lishna, this is the language that he said, I reviewed and examined and analyzed everything we did. I am willing to swear to you in the name of the Almighty. He points to her body and he says to her, this body can never have children, and I swear it that I've never had children. We say, do you understand what's going on here? You think you do chesed for Yenim? You're doing chesed for yourself. She was willing to sacrifice and to get married to someone who's about to die. Wow, what a big chesed. It is a big chesed. But her whole binyan achayim came as a result of that. There is so many things to learn from this maaseh. Emunas chachamim. Tamim tiyeh im Hashem Elokecha wholeheartedly with the Kodesh Baruch Hu, your God. Naaseh v'nishma. Mesirus nefesh, but above all, I think. Chesed, you never lose from chesed. I understand. Rav Tenenbaum was all about chesed. You do chesed for someone else? You do chesed for yourself. So you know, people ask all the time. This is a very strange thing, as we said before, what Moshe said. I don't think any of us would say that to a young couple that comes and asks. So why do we go to Gedolim to ask? Go and ask your parents. Hopefully you do. Go and ask professionals. Go and ask the doctors. Why do we go collectively? We, Klal Yisrael, we go ask all kinds of questions that seemingly are not halachic based. Why do we go ask Gedolim? Let me ask you a shayla, Rabbi Yisrael. Just give me the first thing that comes to your mind when I say the World Trade Center. Three words, the World Trade Center. What do you think about? 9/11, terror, blood, what else? 3,000 people dead. Good. What do you think about when I tell you about a 5-bedroom beautiful apartment? If you're a guy, you're probably thinking about a big mortgage. The ladies are probably thinking about, oh, probably beautiful view, I can see the ocean. What do you think about when I tell you the word tank? A tank. What do you think about?
A war. Missiles. Blood. Soldiers. The first thing that come to our mind.
You know, in Tel Aviv, there's a river called the Yarkon River. Nahar Yarkon. Ever been there? When you ask an Israeli, what do you think when I say Nahar Yarkon, the Yarkon River? The first thing, if you were taken there when you're a kid from school, so you're probably thinking about a little boat, a boat ride, or... The first time Reb Shlomo Zalman Auerbach Zecher Tzadik Livrocho heard such a thing in the world called the World Trade Center, it doesn't end on the four floors. He said, oh, that's fascinating. You know what that means? It could be two babies born at the same time. One, the first floor, and the other, all the way on top. And the Bris Mila will be in different days. Why? Because the one on the bottom, it's already Shkia, a long time ago, 25 minutes ago. So the Bris is going to be in 9 days from now. But the one over there on the 104th, floor, still daylight over there, it's not Shkia there, and therefore in 8 days from now, oh, that's very interesting, and he started to hold his big cheshbon. That's the first thing that came to his mind. One of Reb Chaim Kanievsky's grandsons came to him a few years ago and said, you know, Rebbe, grandfather, we bought a new house, a new apartment, 5-bedroom, and the first thing Reb Chaim told him is, oh, you're going to have so much work, b'dikas chametz. Reb Chaim himself, in his huge place, takes a few hours. So if you have 5 bedrooms, you know how long it's going to take you? When Reb Chaim was just a young man sitting in Koiler, in Bnei Brak, there was a war going on. And one of the Avrechim in the Koiler saw him running around, and the Koiler taking this safe and taking this safe, and says, Reb Chaim, you're not worried? There are tanks out there! They're shooting! And Reb Chaim told him, no, the only nafkamina tank for us is a kli mekabel tuma or not. That's the first thing that came in his mind when he said the word tank. When Reb Chaim was young, his father, the stadtholder, used to call him Chaime. And once he took Chaime to the Yarkon River, to the Nahara Yarkon. He took him to pick alavois for sukkis. So he goes to this direction and he goes here to look for them, and then suddenly the stipender calls him. Chaime, Chaime, Chaime! He runs over. What happened? Look. Hayeroka shalpnei hamayim. We say it in Bamei Madlikin, Perek Beis the Shabbos. Because when the stipender goes to the Nahara Yarkon, the Mishnah goes with him. That's the only thing he can see. Why do we go ask Gidoyim? Because instead of having blood running in their veins like we do, they have Torah running in their veins. That's the only thing on their mind. It's the only essence of them is Torah. So when you ask a gadol a shayla, you're asking not what do you think in the mind of Torah and das Torah. You're asking Torah itself. Is it necessarily going to work? Not necessarily. A Kodesh Baruch Hu will decide. It's his world. But you're asking someone who doesn't have any negius. He thinks with Torah because the Torah talks from his head, because it's the only thing he has there. There is no blood in his veins. There is Torah. We mentioned a story about the Kotler family. Similar, not exactly. 5 years ago, there was a young couple in Bnei Brak that got engaged. Shortly after, unfortunately, they found Yerem Machla by the Chosim. A whole year of different treatments, the Kala was very supportive, encouraging, and she was there the whole time. And Baruch Hashem, after a year, he's clear. Baruch Hashem, they're getting married, getting ready for the wedding. The Chassan writes a letter to his Kala. Dear Kala, thank you so much for the support you showed me during this year. You were unbelievable. However, I don't think you should get married to me. You are such a terrific girl. Why should you marry me? I'm high risk. In Hebrew, there's an expression, you don't put a healthy head into a sick bed. Why would you want to do this? And don't worry, I will not be matpit. The Kala writes a letter to the Chassan. Dear Chassan, I want to marry you. The interesting thing about this maise, Oilam hafuch ra'isi. The parents of both sides say the same thing, like their kids. The parents of the Chassan say to the parents of the Kala, we don't think your daughter should marry our son. Your daughter is a mitsuyenis. She is so special. She can find so many guys, great guys out there. Why should she marry our son? He's a high risk. The parents of the Kala write back and they say, we want that your kid will marry our daughter. He's terrific. What do? You go ask a Das Toya. You go to a Din Toya. They decided to go to Rav Vozner Zecher Tzadik Livroch. They call the Gabbai. Gabbai, we want to go in to Rav Vozner, the whole families, and tell them the whole Maisa. The Gabbai says, listen, Rav Vozner is 99 years old. There's many other Rabbonim in Bnei Brak. Why do you want to go bother him with the Din Toya that you have now? They tell him, Gabbai, HaRav Vozner in his 99 years never saw such a Din Toya, we promise you. They got it. They sit there, both families, and Rav Vozner listens, and he says to the Kala, but why do you want to marry him? And the Kala says, Rebbe, if I'm not going to marry him, who will marry him? I already know him. We're already engaged, and he's a great guy. But if I don't marry him, who will marry him? So am I not allowed to marry him? Rav Vozner tells her, you should know you do not have to marry him and he cannot have any kpeid on you. Rebbe, but am I not allowed to marry him? I didn't say that. Rebbe, am I allowed to marry him? And Rav Vozner told her, you are allowed to, but if you leave, he's not going to have any kpeid on you. He's not allowed to have any kpeid. Rebbe, am I allowed to? Yes. So I want to marry him. Rav Vozner starts crying. But Rebbe, she says to him, I want you to give us a bracha. Rav Vozner picks up his head, he's crying, and he tells her, Bas Yisrael, that behaves with such nobility, wants a bracha from me? I want a bracha from you. And he asked her for a bracha for Arichus Yamim. It worked. He got another 3 years. He was 102. HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't just ask us to do chesed. HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, I want ahavas chesed. And when you love something, you pursue it. You don't just do it. You look for opportunities how you can help. Anifta Adogul, I understand that was his whole mahus. That was everything that he was about. Ahavas chesed. To help others. Yehi rotzon. Bizchus chesed. HaKadosh Baruch Hu yisma lerachami. Ala mishpacha. On Klal Yisrael, and will bring us Mashiach Tzidkenu Bekorov V'Yameinu Amen.